Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hello, and good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure for me to introduce you to Chris Dancy. I met Chris last year at DFRAC 2013 in Colorado. And, you know, I was really impressed by his presentation. He's a great speaker, but more than that, he's going to be talking about some very, very interesting topics today. Chris is considered the most connected man in the world. And that's not his term, it's the term that, you know, people have used. So he'll talk a bit more about that. He's also a data exhaust cartographer. And again, he'll be mentioning some of those things later. But, you know, I really hope that you enjoy the talk. And by all means, you know, ask questions. And the hope is that this is going to be interactive. And the same for people in the webcast. Please feel free to send me questions, and I'll ask those on your behalf. And with no further ado, I'll leave you with Chris Dancy here.
Thanks. It's a real honor to be here, and actually hold an actual Microsoft branded cup. It's very exciting. So, data exhaust cartographer. I never had anyone actually use my title before, so it was kind of changed everything I was going to say. So data, we all know what that is, right? Data exhaust is like all the information falling off of you. Do you remember Pigpen? How many of you know Charlie Brown? Remember Pigpen? He always, no matter what happened, he had that just following around. So data exhaust is like everything that you are, even if you're not carrying anything electronic. That's all the information that you create, you're walking around with. And as a child, my parents didn't have great means, so I got a book in elementary school of 101 things kids can do for free. And one of the things was you could write to the different states in the United States. This is the 70s for some of you. And then you could ask them for things from their state. So all the states I started writing to would send me maps. And in my room was just covered with maps. And then finally I started writing to countries once I actually got a little bit of, I could afford postage. And countries would send me maps. So I grew up in love with maps. And I always dreamed that I would be in those cities. And then when his maps kind of evolved over the decade or so that I wrote around and asked for maps, maps got more complex. They'd have like populations and like topography, and they became very complex. They weren't just very simple maps from 1975. By 1985, I had really cool looking maps. But I always thought, gosh, how amazing, how much information and how much perspective you can get from a map. So cartography is the art of making maps. So when I started this, I don't even know what to call it, experiment or project 5 years ago, I really just wanted to understand how I would describe it to someone. I said, well, it's kind of like making a map of your life. And I thought, well, that doesn't make sense. So I said, I always use cartography because it's a fancier word. So data exhaust cartographer. So that's kind of what that means. So the appointment was called the Human Information System. So we're going to cover a lot of different things and BYOD and other stuff. This is from an old talk that I took and just threw a lot of it away and just created something unique for you guys. And I'm okay with machines going off because you should come visit my house. It's like, what's going on? Why are all these things talking? So I created a faux agenda because we'll never actually make it through all this, or we will and we won't cover any of it adequately. But I'd like to talk about my bias because it's a good idea. You know what my bias is already because of some of the things you've heard about me or my introduction, but I think it's good to just for me to say them. And then where this title came from, and then the three driving problems I see in today's world from a technology standpoint, the three driving data types that are driving those problems. I call it Wearables 100, because if you want to do Wearables 101, there's just someone in the room who can actually do that for you and do it properly. Although I use wearables, I'm no expert in wearables. I think I'm an expert in what it looks like when it all's put together in 5 years. Some solutions, because it's nice to tell you guys how I think you should think about your jobs, but more importantly, your careers. You know, I'll be working for, I'm 45, I'll probably be working for another 40 years, so that's a long time. A lot can happen in 40 years. And then these concepts of existence as a platform, which I think are really important to understand. Humanity as the platform, which is the evolution beyond that. And then I would really like to get to this, and I think we will, because I'll move very fast if it's okay with you guys. And that's kind of what's really driving why we're seeing this rapid change. And I think it's this collapse of three basic human elements, and that's ownership, narrative, and identity. We all have, we all kind of grew up in a world, unless you're under 10, those are the magic children. Anybody have children under 10? God, those are magic children. We all grew up with some concept of ownership, but most people don't have, they're starting to lose their concept of ownership. Narrative, we all grow up having a concept of a story, a narrative, a timeline, but we're losing that very rapidly. And we all have a concept of identity, and we talked about that before this session, that we're starting to lose kind of very rapidly. And then kind of three core solutions if I was creating products or looking at jobs in the future. So I'm going to go over three quick slides. They're kind of like joke slides, because you know every speaker does those terrible joke slides that are supposed to make you laugh. But these three slides are specifically addressing digital dualism. Is anybody familiar with the term digital dualism? Okay. So it's this concept that there's an online and offline world. Because there really isn't an online and offline world. There's a world, and then there are people who put you or subjugate you into one of those things. So objectify you. Oh, look, you're online. Oh, look, you're on your device. Oh, look, you're not paying attention, right? And when you introduce technology to that, you have this digital duality, right? Oh, you're not on vacation. You're taking pictures of vacation. And we do all these very pathological things to people to kind of make them feel less than human or make you feel more human than they are because you don't have a relationship with technology. I love how everyone perks up during this section. And it's okay, right? We didn't conquer email etiquette. We didn't conquer table etiquette. We aren't going to conquer phone etiquette because there is no such thing. We're all individuals. We'll do what we want to do, and that's the way it is. But I thought I'd just go through my kind of three joke slides on digitalism. So the first one is tech fetish, right? So everybody has this concept of tech being this really great thing that's going to save the world. So in this case, you've got this guy saying, you kids with your cloud computers and your googly docs, in my day we attach files to emails and we like that that way. And he says, Dave, you're only 2 years older than me, right? So, you know, there's this whole thing where like you can just play the age card or the maturity card or the experience card and like shame someone to thinking that they're, you know, not doing their job. And I don't think tech is something to be shamed or celebrated. So although I might have elements of tech fetish in my presentation, I want you to know I certainly don't fetishize tech, although I would like to. I just have learned it's not that sexy. The other thing is tech pathology. And we were talking about this earlier, right? Tech is ruining us. It's making us more isolated. And, you know, there's this narcissism and everything else. And this is a picture from, I think, the 1930s of people on a bus or a train. And they're not paying attention to each other. And I like to remind people all the time, although I've recently started dating someone new and it's been really difficult for me because this person's constantly on their phone. I don't know how people who are dating actually live. But there's this concept that I used to talk about on stage, which is now really uncomfortable because it's affecting me personally, that if someone's not paying attention to you, they're on their phone, that somehow they have an attention problem. But it's truly, if I'm at my core, my best, I'm rested and fed, if someone's not paying attention to me because they're on their device, I have the attention problem. I need it, right? So I think we have to be very careful with this. And the last piece of pathology that we're going to look at is this. And it's from a principal publication from 1815. It's the students today depend too much on paper. They don't know how to write on a slate without getting chalk and dust all over themselves. They can't clean paper or slate properly. What will they do when they run out of paper? So. It really doesn't matter how we look at any of these cool, fun, futuristic topics. Somebody's going to break them apart and make you feel ugly. So I just want you to like have that Dove commercial moment and know that you're okay. Okay? For those who don't know, Dove commissioned this thing where they asked, I think it was they asked friends of people to describe them and the sketch artists drew them, and then they asked that person to describe them. And then they had the ladies come back in the room, and the ladies saw the picture that they described versus the picture their friends described. And they were so beautiful with what their friends described. But when they describe themselves, they're just not as beautiful. So I just want you to know that from a technology standpoint, you're all very beautiful to me. I don't care what you do with it. That being said, I do know that once you get to about 70% on your phone's battery, you start feeling like life is going to end. Because anything is possible between 95 and 100% battery, but after that, you start to know there's only so much time left, right, you can do, right? But when you're at 100%, do you ever notice you feel a little bit better when your battery is at 100%? So we have a very real relationship with technology. I just don't know why we're not talking about it more. It's so real, though, that we're doing crazy things with it. So these are just some fun examples that I pulled out from a very old deck because I think they're very relevant. So this was a guy, he's a homeless guy. So they paid homeless people 2 years ago, 3 years ago, to be human hotspots for advertising during South by Southwest. So you walked up to these homeless people and got wireless access. This is FedEx paid people to be a charging station. There's stories of children who live, you know, in video games. I think this might even be through an Xbox. Facebook had this great message last year in April. They tweeted out and it said, hey, your friends are waiting inside your phone. Set them free. And I thought, wow, do people realize what they're saying? Okay, that's cool. See a little bit of digital duality there. See me playing with that? Wow, you're in your phone. And then you notice there's this whole concept of people talking in memes. And we'll talk a little bit about some of this kind of crazy stuff later. And then, you know, people are their phones and that sort of thing. Well, we have all sorts of fun things to talk about. And then, of course, people waiting in line to buy tech for you. So this is a task rabbit who was paid to wait in line to buy tech. So world's most connected human. So I didn't name myself that. Last year, when people started writing about me, I was known as the world's most surveilled man. And now I'm the world's most connected human. And it was a BBC that kind of coined it, and then Mashable ran it and spun it, and then, I mean, name drop the media outlet. And I was just on the cover of Business Week 3 weeks ago, and, you know, world's most connected human, and a whole spread, and I'm shirtless in it, which is really embarrassing. But and you'll find out why it's embarrassing in a minute for a second. But I didn't make that up. It's a media thing, and maybe you'll figure out why when we get more into what I did. So this whole journey starts off with a very simple day and time. In 1968, I was born. In 2008, I turned 40. So turning 40 is one of those things where you dread your whole life to happen, and you go, that's it? Like, there's no parade, and, like, I don't get an adult card, or all the things you think will happen when you turn 40 don't happen. So you don't die, you know. I just had all these things that were gonna happen. But I did know that I was wearing, like, a blazer, and, like, I had this really ridiculous hair, and, like, I had, like, this cheesy business smile, and, like, you know, it's perfect for LinkedIn, right? But in reality, it wasn't me, right? But at 40, I said to myself, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to make the same amount of money that I make now when I'm 50. I was looking at the year 2020. It's like, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to make that money in 12 years when I'm 50. So what do I need to know? So at 40, I thought, well, I can't go back to school. I could go back to school, but I don't know if I could learn enough to actually be employable and make the same income. So I did all the things I could learn that I actually could either teach myself or learn through reading. And personal informatics was the one I picked. It was very, very kind of interesting. Personal informatics has been around a long time, but because of the digital revolution, personal informatics was kind of new again. So I said to myself, wow, what could I do if I wanted to document or record parts of my life? Fast forward to 2013, and then we'll talk about what happened in between 2008 and 2013. 2013, I was sitting at something called Cyborg Camp. I'm sorry, 2012. I was sitting in the fall in Portland. I was sitting at something called Cyborg Camp. And your friends always love it when you tell them you're going to Cyborg Camp. And this guy said, hey, are you, you know, the guy with the crazy something? And I'm like, yeah, and I showed it to the organizer, whose name is Amber Case. Wonderful, wonderful, beautiful, beautiful, very intelligent, kind person. And she goes, you need to show everyone this. And I'm like, no, I'm really embarrassed. She goes, you need to show everyone this. So I showed everyone. Next thing happened, Wired ran a piece on me, and then 2013 happened. And 2013 was just crazy because I was still relatively heavy, and I was like, on the radio, and then my friends were calling me saying, I heard you on the radio, and then, like, I'm doing a live video cast with Wired, and, like, I just wasn't ready for this, because I'm, like, IT operations guy, you know, SQL is my thing, Exchange is my baby, you know, so I'm, like, I'm that guy. I'm the guy, like, that keeps all it running and makes you feel bad about it. I wasn't ready to be kind of this kind of freakish cyborg person, because this was just a hobby. But there was a lot of interesting things that came out of 2013. One of them was people on the internet are really mean. I'll just leave that alone. So they're just really mean. In the fall of 2013, I can't do this. This is really too invasive. And people calling my home and following me around and just strange stuff. And, you know, you just don't want to be the Paris Hilton of tech. You just don't want that, right? That's a very tweetable thing, by the way. So I said, I'm going to stop. So I just hid for like 3 months. And my work, this is really hard when you have a real job too. And I say real job with a lot of dualism in there too, because your real companies are mad at you. Like, why aren't you talking about our products? Well, it's got nothing to do with like me, you know, like, but they, you know, kind of deal with it. So I hid, but then 2014 came, and then the Wall Street Journal, Mashable, Fox. If you can make it through a Fox News interview, you can do anything. BBC, Independent, just globally, it just started exploding this year. It's been really, really difficult in some cases. Some people who really follow tech will see me on the street and go, hey, you're the guy. It helps if I don't gear up. I don't have a lot of gear on today. So people don't notice you when you're not wearing tech, which is a whole other story we talk about. And then it just kind of went crazier. And then I was like, I kept getting alerts from all these different countries, and all these people on Facebook following me in different languages, asking me questions in different languages I couldn't answer. Because I think a lot of it's this picture. People love these freaky pictures. There's stories behind those types of things too. And then just this month, oh, sorry, we're in July, in June, for the global tech issue of Business Week, I'm on the cover. There's a little me. And this is the internal spread in it, where they actually tell my story, which you can watch this 30 or 40 minute chat in 3 minutes if you want to on their website in a video, or read the article in 10 minutes or less. So that's how I got here. How did I do it? Well, I, in my journey to become employable in 2020 and understand personal informatics, said, what's the biggest problem I face now with personal information? And mine was I didn't understand my health. At 40, I weighed a little over 300 pounds. My highest, I weighed 320 pounds. I weigh 190 pounds today. I was smoking 2 packs of cigarettes a day. I was drinking about 30 cans of Diet Coke a day, and drinking pretty good clip on the weekends. But at 40 in a high-tech job, you're living. That's when you've earned it, right? And you can just eat what you want and do what you want. I thought, well, gosh, maybe I should understand my health. So I started by trying to work with my doctor I've had for 20 years. He's really wonderful. Dr. Alford has actually seen videos. Oh, I just said his name. I try never to say his name. he's seen videos of me speak, and he understands now why I talk about him. But the problem was he just was really unaware. I have a chart after 20 years of the same doctor that's like this thick and another chart that's that thick, and he can't find anything. And I'd go to visit him, and we'd talk about the weather. We'd spend 5 minutes talking about everything, and he'd go, what do you need again? And like I'd say, and he'd write a script and walk out of the room. And that was my relationship with my doctor. It wasn't very Mayberry-ish, but never was. So I started, you see here in 2006, I started in Notepad, Microsoft Notepad, keeping track of my visits to my doctor and what he told me and my own stats and stuff, so I could just do a control F and find what he didn't know. And it used to really freak him out, and he'd get really mad at me and stuff. And then around 2008, I started using WebMD a lot to like find out how many cancers I had, so I could go in and tell him I was dying, so he could invalidate his medical degree and he could give me the prescriptions I actually wanted. And then in 2010, I went in after about a year of collecting my own information from him and just got all of those medical records and then sent them through Mechanical Turk, had them all scanned, then sent them through Mechanical Turk and actually had them all put into spreadsheets and flat files so I could search my own medical history and start to look at my own information. By 2012, I was using some big data sources like Google Flu Trends to start to try to figure out, you know, yeah, I think I have flu symptoms. This is about the time of year I get them, and actually they're in my neighborhood. And say, oh, okay. So then I'd go to my doctor. And about 2011 is when I was fired from my doctor. I still see him on a personal basis. And if I have something, you know, that I actually need to see him for, but he won't see me anymore because he goes, can't you just look that up on your fancy stuff? It's a whole other Oprah when you walk into your doctor with the types of information I have. And then by 2012, I was just using all sorts of stuff at home to measure everything from blood pressure to blood glucose and stuff that nobody really cares about, but I just thought was really interesting. Also, at the same time, I started playing with Ubiome, which is microbiomes, and 23andMe, and then also finding random labs that would do blood work without, because you can't just have blood work done. You actually can. It's kind of like black market. And you can actually have genetic testing done. There are a lot of companies that do this now. So I started really messing with that. So this is really kind of what I'm focusing on, this in psychology for the stuff I'm doing next year. So everything you're seeing now is stuff I kind of hidden for a while. Problem two was I was connected to a lot of stuff. So behind these placards, travel, content, environment, entertainment, spiritual, work, social, money, opinion, and health are my data. So like I had to go into a bunch of different systems to understand what I was doing. And I just think that's really painful for people. Like you shouldn't have to go into like 11 different sites and 21 different applications to know what you did, right? If you want to find something, you should be able to find it. The fact that I can pull up my phone and go on Bing, yes, or Google or anything I want and like find a local Chinese restaurant that has a kids menu within 2 miles that can seat six within an hour, I can find that out instantly, but I can tell you what I did last Tuesday. That to me is criminal that we've done this with technology. We've made it so convenient that we've distanced ourselves from any type of relationship. So I thought to myself, well, how can anyone function like this? Especially if you just consider like some of the bigger problems we grew up, like someone said, you know, learn to balance your checkbook or entertainment was a big one. Like, what are you reading? What are you listening to? You know, all the types of things we rely on so heavily. The third problem was probably the biggest one that I found, and that was from Nintendo, and that's everything that's saved will be lost. And that's just a fact. I mean, if you throw it away, you'll want it. How have you even dug through trash looking for something important, like keys or a receipt? We will dig through trash looking for something we've thrown away because it's like we're so used to throwing things away. So I took those three problems, my medical, all the information I was touching, and then everything that saved, and said there has to be a solution for this. So what I did was I broke things into three layers. Soft data, hard data, and core data. So soft data is anything you touch electronic where you can manipulate or construct an identity. So social networks are probably the easiest one to understand because a lot of people construct identities in social networks. But you can construct an identity by email. You all know people who reply to all to say thank you. You all know people who like, you know, just do crazy stuff, right? You have constructed images digitally, but they're becoming easier now that we have a lot more ways to manipulate them with photos and filters, location, and a lot of other information. Hard data, the data from sensors on you, that's harder to manipulate, right? Unless you're a yogi of some type and you can lower your heart rate and your body temperature, right? It's really hard for most people to manipulate their how you're sitting in your seat is how you're sitting in your seat, how far forward you are, how far back you are, how your feet are propped or not propped. I'll tell you the biggest problem with being connected like me is you see information. You're like that kid from The Sixth Sense. I can't look through this room without just seeing crazy. It's like The Matrix to me at this point. It's like, damn, you know, do you guys know what's around you? But you're just in a room talking to some guy, right? But yeah, I see more. But hard data is harder to manipulate. And I think this is really important because hard data being harder to manipulate is fundamentally important to core data. Core data is the genetics and blood work and all the things that make you who you are at the core. The interesting thing about this is you can manipulate core data, genetic information, blood work, and other things through environmental information, which is hard data. The temperature is the temperature is the temperature. You are standing, you are the body weight you are. Your blood cholesterol is what it is, what it is, what it is, until it's influenced through an environmental or a behavior change by you. Are we all on the same page? So you can actively change what you're given at birth or at conception, but you need to look at this. Soft data is here is because most people are living in this world of soft constructed data and identity, and we're talking about wearables, so the hard data. But that's how I broke it down, because I thought I need to understand these systems and how I can influence one system to another. If I wanted to lose weight, do I stay off of Facebook or do I run? Right? Do I not listen to this type of music or do I spend more money? Right? All of these things actually work together to lose weight. You just don't change your diet to lose weight. If changing your diet and exercising to lose weight worked consistently, a lot of people would fluctuate in weight a lot more because we're all changing our diets and moving more or less all the time, and our weight's not changing that much. So it's a lot of different systems that actually make that happen. So for me, I've got the health systems all the way from, you know, simple little things that you have on your body and you can test, to my experience systems, and a lot of those are in my vehicle, on my pets, in my home, around my home. And they all kind of work together. So at any given time, there's upwards of 170 at minimum to 700 simultaneously data points being collected on me. You're like, how is that even possible? Well, right now I'm speaking at a certain tone. My phone's capturing everything I'm saying. If I speak at this level, it just triggered that it just went up a decibel. I actually know the difference in decibels. Also, how I'm standing is changing, when I'm moving my hands, when I'm not, where I am, my relationship to you. A lot of these things are changing, and there's applications to pick up all of this type of information. We just don't use the information. No one really sees a need for it now, but everything not saved will be lost. And you can't look at it if you don't have it. So just using one application, you touch 30 different systems. How many of you, you know, in one of the articles I did, I said, you know, I counted most people are attached to at least 150 to at least 200 systems at minimum. They just don't think about their life as systems. When they swipe a club card, use a credit card, or get in their car, and all the computing and in their car, remove all what we call laptops and phones, you are touching a lot of stuff. But you have no idea what that relationship looks like. And what could you learn if you could pull it out? We're all on the same page so far. This is interesting. Thank you. So nervous. I grew up on Microsoft. It's like I've spoke all over. I've spoke at Google. I've spoke at like all the cool places you'd want to speak. I've spoken to all these countries. I'm going to Microsoft. I'm like, God, you were on my keyboard for like 20 years. The three areas I really focused on in the beginning were activity, sleep, movement, and environment. And that was ambient light, ambient sound, temperature, humidity, and air quality. That's really how I got started. If I could just figure out my activity versus my sleep versus my movement versus those things, I could really start to get a handle on things. And we talked about this earlier, and it's not in this presentation. So I'll just give you an example because I was showing everyone earlier. A great little company called Cube makes these little sensors for your room. And of course, you know, you can measure your sleep with all these little sensors. Well, Cube will monitor light, sound, temperature, air quality, and some other things. And then, of course, one of these sensors will measure your sleep deep or not, right? But there's this great little routine I have that actually just puts all of these things on a graph, right? I'm not going to draw a bunch of graphs. But what's neat is when you look at your sleep, like, you know, like, oh, I was a little bit restless there, and you go, oh, wow, the air quality was really funky right there. You can actually see it, right? And you're like, oh, that's really interesting. And then I was explaining it earlier, and then you pull in things like lunar activity or solar activity, and you actually put them on the same thing. You're like, wow, I'm affected by the sun. NASA's got some really great open data that you can look at with this sort of thing. But if you just stayed small, like your body in your room, like that's cool stuff to know. And you can actually do things like then say, okay, if the temperature or air quality or one of these other things you can actually environmentally manipulate changes and it affects my sleep, you know, hack my Nest thermostat to change the temperature, servo on one of the windows to crack the window to get some more fresh air in. You know, little things you can do in the environment so you just sleep deeper, right? You don't need Ambien, you need algorithms. Oh, that's a good one. I wish I could, you know, actually I am recorded for my safety. What I said next was, okay, I need a really a low friction way to collect this information because it's a lot of work to write stuff down. For those of you who are writing, God bless you. So what does data collection look like? And I said, well, like if you're writing on a cave wall and it's like 200,000 years ago or whatever your belief system is, that's a lot of work, right? You burn a stick and draw and pray it stays. If you go to like, you know, 700-800 years ago and you have to deal with a shaman, right? You know, if he dies, you're kind of out of luck because like he knew everything. Interesting thing about child mortality, we became really interested in children living longer once we actually had the printing press. No one really looks at, you know, the relationship between child mortality rates and how much we cared about children living versus the elderly living and how that switched once we could record information. So the ability to save information changes a lot of relationships, but I don't want to get your heads too flipped out just yet. Then we got into like the printing press and then recording information by newspapers, which is just a book that happens every day. Then the mass media, computing, we all got into computing. And then kind of relationships with sensors. And then, you know, you get into neuro and biological and automation here. I think a lot of our economic woes are stuck because we are stuck right here in between 5 and 6 inches. We have mass media and computing, and we're not doing anything else with collecting information easily. We're storing lots of it. Everyone likes to talk about big data. Like, I don't know why. But, like, that's like saying, you know, oil. Yeah, we've got lots of oil. You know, it's like 1976 in the oil crisis, except like now we're calling it big data. You know, and there's, you know, money to be made from big data. There's no money to be made from big data. I mean, sure, you can make money selling idiots information, but the idea is you need this information. So, how could I low frictionally collect this information? So I wouldn't use a system unless I could get it by not doing anything. I didn't want to have to record anything. I didn't want anything to happen. So I'll give you a little hack. A lot of times, a lot of these closed loop systems, whether it's, I don't know, I don't pick on any particular product, Spotify. I'll pick on a product. Spotify won't let you know what you're listening to, right? But they will let you create a relationship between Spotify and Last.fm. Last.fm has this thing called Scrobble, Scobble, how do you pronounce it? Scrobble, Scobble, Scobble, which basically scrubs and tells you what you're listening to. So everyone, someone can see what you've listened to all day long. Well, you can then use an RSS feed from that to port that information into something you can actually manipulate. So what you listen to and how you're feeling is really a fun little thing to play with. Fitbit, lovely little company they are. They're like the Roach Motel of wearables because you can't get your information out at all. And you have to go into their app to look at it. It's like, you know, it's terrible. Thank you. But Fitbit won't give your information in any kind of intangible way, but they will let you tweet it. So this is like the greatest hack in the world. Almost every system you use has a auto-share feature. So I just created hundreds of fake Twitter accounts that were hidden and turned everything to auto-share and then scraped Twitter, which I could get to. All right, so there are ways you can get to your information if you want it. You just have to know, like, how does it fit in the bigger scheme of things. So I broke my life into really 10 areas. Health, which then broke into food, activity, sleep, restroom. Yes, I know it's ugly. It goes into more deeper than that. And then each one of these actually has subsections. So activity has subsections. I was talking earlier, what I did was I created a human data table of elements, kind of like a periodic table of elements. Entertainment, so what I listen to, watch, read. Environment, social media, because you spend a lot of time on your phone connecting with other people. Knowledge work, what I would do to get paid at my big company that I don't work for anymore. Travel, where I go, what I do. Opinion, I think this is really important. Sometimes we take time to leave feedback for people, whether it's for a restaurant or for a friend. And how and when you have opinions or feedback for people is so critical for your development as a fully centered person. I didn't understand how important it was when I gave feedback that wasn't angry, why I was doing it. I don't want to get all crazy on you, but opinion was important for me to start to understand. Content creation. Did I actually create something that was usable for someone else and they consumed it? A lot of times in marketing, they like to talk about, you know, metrics and views and things like that. Well, that's interesting, but did it help someone's life? And you have to look at two systems emerging then. Money and then spirituality. So I started practicing MBSR, mindfulness, about 3 years ago because the volume of information I was looking at was a little bit overwhelming. And I wanted to start to pull it all together. And Oscar would tell you, I'm a little bit different now than I was just last fall because a lot of these things are starting to align. My neurology and my actual belief systems are aligning with my body. As my body is changing, they're all starting to affect each other. But for those of you in the room, it's just a big feedback loop. I'm nothing special. I don't have amazing powers. I have good feedback loops. I'm just a rat in a cage, right? Just like the who said that? Rat in a cage. Da, 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 da. I don't know which band. Smashing Pumpkins. Thank you, whoever just sent me Smashing Pumpkins through the air because I felt it. I was one of you in here who did that. So then I said, well, this is great that I have this low friction and I'm not like, if I touch it, it gets recorded ugly, but how do I know whether it's good or not? Like, so what? I touched it. Is it good or not? So I took the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, actually, it's color coded if you actually look at it. I mean, they're there, but they're also, they put a spectrum on it. So I just said, based on Maslow's hierarchy of needs, how important is some of this stuff? So if I've got time to travel and create stuff that people love and share my opinion, I'm really at a high level, all right? But I actually need like a really healthy life and my environment needs to be good. I need to make money, you know, what I do, you know, for entertainment and meeting people and stuff, you know, there's a need. So once I understood kind of where my data lied at its highest level and I was collecting it, I said, well, now the most important thing is, can I see it? Like, I know I can like write it all down and collect it all, but can I see it? So I have this very simple mantra that I use for my information, reflect, collect, protect, project. So this is collect, right? Collect the information. So I said, how do I see myself? So what I did was I just used calendar. So basically, anytime anything happens, it gets written to a calendar automatically in the background, color-coded to what I was doing. So it was easy because I could say, show me environment and finances, and I could see the relationship from a visual point of view. Show me spirituality and health. Is there a relation? Is there at least a visual relationship I can start to understand? And this is when I came to the first concept that I think is just so really important, and that's if your phone's turned off, no matter what type of phone you have, if there's no emitting light, you can see a reflection of yourself, right? And you're beautiful, like I said with the Dove commercial today. But if you turn your phone on, Is there anything, any app you can open right now that shows me anything nice about you? Maybe Facebook, but that's not you. That's what your friends think of you. You've been, you know, taught to behave like a, like, you know, like a, like, you know, you've been trained to behave a certain way on Facebook. I'm not gonna ruin your day, but that's not you. But is there, what can you open that shows me how good you are? Nothing, right? And I just think we all do so many successful things every day. We have nothing in our lives that, that reinforce that. I sometimes say it's, you know, instead of big brother, big mother. Right? It doesn't have to be a big brother. We can create a big mother. And then protect. So like moving everything in the flat files and other storage systems to actually, so I can search it and manipulate it. Some more project, so moving it into spreadsheets, online spreadsheets, manipulating it, looking at it. And then finally projecting. I use Stanford's deep learning engine to dump volumes of information into it to kind of get sentiment analysis on kind of just a flat file of data for a week to understand kind of was there something I could have learned that I didn't know myself. So how does that work? So during my interview for Business Week, I'm like, you know, I didn't know I was going to be on the cover and the centerfold and all the other kind of crazy stuff. But they said to me, hey, we're going to run the story. It's a great story. We think it's really interesting, but we need to fact check you. And I'm like, what does that mean? He goes, I need to ask you a question right now, and you need to answer right now. I said, okay. And he goes, what did you do on August 11th, 2013? This is what I did. So I'll just warn you that this is hundreds of pages for August 13th. But I just started reading to him because I put the calendar in diary view instead of like appointment view, and I just read it like a script from the time. And of course, he was like, you are just good. You're just, this is amazing, you know? And so it's fun because when you can search your life, you actually have an interesting way of looking at things. You're not just looking for things that help you, you're looking at things that are you. So, you know, that's really, really important. And now I'll just leave that up there because people love, you know, I used to show them Facebook and people would just stop paying attention to me and just look at my Facebook screen. But now I put this up and people just go crazy because there's a certain amount of authenticity that comes across that just beats Facebook's head in, like bashes it in when you have this to share. And like I said, this is just really the simple highlights of that day. But for me, it doesn't stop there. You know, I go a little bit deeper, as I said earlier, with using the genetic information. I'm really into microbiomes now and how they affect my life. But some very simple things for you to think about as far as my journey is concerned. So the environmental relationship is a very simple indoor sensor versus a sensor in my vehicle. And this is a very simple CO2 chart telling you what how you function at different CO2 levels. And I couldn't understand why some days I was actually more hostile, more aggressive, or more sleepy. I was just all over the map with some behaviors. And it first came to me when I was in my truck and started having sensors on my pets and realized, wait, there's some days where the pets just aren't as happy and I know I'm not driving any different. And that's when I started looking, kind of digging through the needle of the haystack, and it was actually environmental, what was happening in the house before we ran out and hopped in the truck. And again, you know, this is information I think that should just be available to people, but we're just, I think in some ways, we're not thinking too much about it. This is something else interesting that I found. I would perform an activity, and then systems would go and have relationships with that activity that I was unaware of. It's very kind of creepy the way these things start to talk to each other and how just a pebble in the pond creates this ripple effect across all these things that you touch in your life. Very, 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 very spiritual at a very deep level when you see how interconnected these digital things are.
Can you give a concrete example of that?
Nothing that won't freak everybody out. It's just really uncomfortable.
Yeah,
I have an example two slides from now that I'll show you that's not as crazy, but it's kind of fun. So the coolest thing was after I had 3 years worth of information, I said to myself, what can I do with this information? So can I do anything meaningful other than visualize it and start to explore my life? And I thought, well, actually, I have 3 years of information. Why don't I figure out I've got a weight problem and a smoking problem, and I shouldn't call them problems, but I have some issues. Can I use the information to help me within these issues? So I started constructing what I call a data-assisted life. Just like you'd have a GPS, like all the information is the GPS, but telling the GPS where you want to go is a goal. So I took the last 2 years and I stopped smoking and lost 120 some, almost 130 pounds, cut my Diet Coke. I meditate pretty regularly. I'm a lot kinder, a lot calmer, a lot slower. But I have a lot of feedback loops that are constantly buzzing and saying, you know, oh, okay, oh, you're doing that. And there's some very simple things you can do. If you're eating 3,000 calories a day and you want to lose weight without a whole lot of effort, you really only need to cut out around 200 calories a day to lose a little bit of weight. The difference between 3,000 and 2,800 calories is not a lot. You won't miss it, I promise. It's literally a cookie, right? The problem is you don't know what happens on the 3,000 calorie day that doesn't happen on the 2,800 calorie day. With me? I do. So I just literally started orchestrating my environment to create 2,500 calorie days, not 3,000 calorie days, and without really thinking about it, started losing weight. To this day, I'm still losing weight. I have to actually be careful. I wish I could turn some things off now because, like, I don't know what I'm turning into. But you know, it starts to massage you a little bit into this, and then you're like, oh, I actually have lost enough weight to go for a walk, right? Right, and then you actually do it the proper way. But there are some things you can do in the beginning that are, I think, very helpful. Any questions about that concept? Because it's a big concept for people. Any questions so far? Interesting?
Absolutely.
So, to the point that was asked earlier, there's this quote down here. The machine is a tool, but it's not a neutral tool. We're deeply influenced by the machine while we're using it. One of the things I'm presenting at Buddhist Geeks, which is a conference at the end of this year, is I took, last year, I watched three friends of mine for a year on Facebook, and I took pictures of their posts, and their posts that got likes, I actually kept track of and screenshotted, and I started watching how they posted to create a presentation of how they became what their friends liked about them, right down to how they dressed, how they took pictures, where they were. So they were algorithmically moved in or herded into a behavior pattern. And I wanted to show that this isn't happening to me, it's happening to all of us, but it's happening through the systems we use. But this is just one kind of weird example where Rocco has seizures, and Rocco had a seizure one day, and it had this really crazy ripple effect across the rest of my systems where, like, right after Rocco's seizure, obviously I was a little bit less active, my sleep was off, but I also, you know, and Rocco's had seizures for 9 years, so it's not like they bother me anymore, but they do at enough of a level that I'm not sleeping as well, I'm driving a little bit more aggressively, and even electronics in my house act different after Rocco has a seizure. So everything is strangely connected. I just don't think we have the ability to see it yet. I think, you know, scientists would say, well, of course it is. You know, we're all just made of stardust or something like that. No, literally, we are all connected at a really deep level. And not just we. I mean, even this is like, you know, it's a cut. No, I'm telling you right now, it knows I'm here. There's something, but I'm not a scientist. I'm a SQL guy. Remember that. Don't ever get confused with who's talking to you. So I said to myself, what would it look like if you took the Internet of Things and you combined it with the quantified self, which is the movement to measure and record things. And at those meetings, they've run simple things. What'd you do? How'd you do it? What'd you learn? That's the three things they ask you. So I call that the internet. So it's very simple. Just like the internet works today, the internet works in this principle. All the information's there. It's searchable. You can use the information in any way you want. You can have a social part of the internet. You can have home pages on the internet. And literally this week, some person, I don't know this person's name, I'm gonna assume it's April, but she published her page. It's called April Zero. And I think it's just April, if you just Google April Zero. And I don't know this person, but I salute what this person is doing. I'm assuming it's a she, and I'm so sorry if it's not, but she has a page out there where she's just tracking. You can click on these things and actually see where she is and see her blood in real time and her activity in real time and all this information that just most people would never share, right? She took what I did and just made it stunning in real time, right? And this, I think, is such a perfect example of how the internet is going to start to morph the internet. Because there's a level of authenticity and interest that, and home and health and all sorts of improvement that happens at this layer of openness that we're not really used to. With me? All right. So, like I said, I don't know anything about wearable tech. There's a wearable tech and an IoT person and all those other kind of smart people here. But I just have a couple slides on this because I think it's important because wearable tech really makes a lot of this possible. First, I just want to salute the people who have diabetes or have heart disease or anything else who've been had to use tech for the last 20 or so years, because if you ask somebody who's a diabetic, it's not easy. Right? There's a lot of work, and they don't get Fitbit-like apps. They don't get easy, simple solutions, right? And I just want to say, you know, people with hearing problems, people wear eyeglasses, we all know these are not simple things. And it's funny how we've leapfrogged and we've left some of those things behind. That's just my little political platform. I just wanted to say that and get it over with. The other thing is, when it comes to wearable tech, I think, you know, we're really looking at ultimately, this is the only wearable tech most of us will have is our phone in a while. I think there's a lot to be said about that. The other thing I want to make sure we all understand just from a basic level is just because you think wearable tech is kind of function a certain way doesn't mean it should. So I talked about this earlier with the group. I mean, we did a terrible thing when we created computers and we put forms on them, because why would you put a form on a computer? It's paper. Right? There's more you could do with a computer. And the fact that there's forms to fill out on your phone now is crazy. Your phone's really smart, but we don't use our phones for as smart as they are. And wearable computing doesn't have to look like this crazy exoskeleton that's consumerized now in Japan. It can just be very simple things. And this is kind of a history of wearable computing. But I do want to salute, because I would really love people who broke, you know, April Zero, whoever this young lady is, or young man, is a pioneer, I think. But Stephen Mann is a real pioneer in wearable tech. In 1995, he was wearing head-mounted cameras with a lot of body stuff and streaming what he was doing to the internet in 1995. I met people today at Microsoft who have shared with me their visions for this stuff long before anyone was talking about it, or some freak like me who's like, oh, how are you so popular all of a sudden? Well, no, it's not me. There are people who did this stuff much better. There was Locker Project in 2007 wanted to do the same type of thing. Just, it wasn't easy. You know, it needs to be easy and simple. And then as far as, like, should you even consider, like, these types of concepts, I just want to say I have one single rule in my life. If Disney does it, it's safe. I live on that all the time. I go, if Disney would do it, will I do it? And, you know, if Disney wouldn't do it, I won't do it. Would Disney put it in a movie? Would he put it in a ride? So, you know, this was the hats, but now they have magic bands. So, you know, Disney has wearables, right? So if Disney will do it, it is safe. Amazon 2 months ago came out with a marketplace just for wearable technology. If you're not, you know, familiar with wearable, you want to start to look at it. What I'm talking about with the data collection is way on the other side of wearables. If they were to open up these ecosystems, I just kind of did this. But check it out. You know, a narrative camera is pretty cool because you wear it and it just takes a picture every few seconds and you can just see your whole day, you know, thousands and thousands of pictures, of a nice little algorithm to find out the important things. You know, but where we're heading with it, I think, really falls into a lot of different categories. You know, shirts that actually change based on your heart rate or the air quality, life logging, fitness. We all know a lot about fitness, adaptive. So, you know, how many of you have ever used your phone GPS while walking? Have you ever done that? Has anyone ever walked with their phone GPS? And do you spend a lot of time doing this? Okay, so, you know, this is a very simple concept. Shoes with Bluetooth, with haptic sensors that give me a little vibration on the left or right, inside, front, back. Tell the GPS where you want to go, put it in your pocket, and as you need to walk or turn, they move. They don't move you, they move from side to side. The information is kind, it's simple, right? It's assistive, it's not in the way, right? So environmentally, if it's gonna rain, the lights in my house change colors just a little bit. If I need to move, leave for a meeting, physically leave for a meeting, my chair vibrates a little bit. My lights will blink if it's real close to a meeting and it's online or a phone call, right? So I have all these kind of very soft little, you know, you're like, it's like a drug-induced state. You're like, oh, this is really interesting, you know. And then, you know, they've got these crazy things that people have done, like this jacket that hooks to your phone that when someone likes something on Facebook, it hugs you. You know, and then clothing that acts like as a user interface, you can change the volume on your music. Maybe play with Parrot Zeke headphones. They're headphones. I should have brought them. You can get them. The crazy thing about is all the stuff, you can just get it online. It's just headphones. It's Bluetooth, but you actually switch songs, you just swipe, turn up the volume, just turn it up and take a phone call. See what I mean? It's just a lot simpler than looking at the phone, you know, the other kind of stuff. Or we should give voice commands, you know, play, you know, whatever's popular today. I always say Michael Jackson because I'm a huge Michael Jackson fan. But there's lots of wearable stuff. You know, there's a deck that you can see that's got a lot of cooler stuff in it. But, you know, babies, dogs, everything's wearable. But I want to go into the dark part that everyone likes to, like, talk about with this kind of thing. And that's surveillance. So the opposite of surveillance is sous-valence. Valence to observe. But sous-valence is French for to watch yourself. And when you get involved in watching yourself, there's a whole different arena of awareness that starts to happen with you. And I think this is a great quote that I read to you a little bit. I read something similar to this earlier. But we start to become like the machines that we're watching. So if we could watch ourselves, what could we learn if we were to create a self-feedback loop? So the first thing is we need to get over this concept of surveillance. Surveillance can be a good thing. So this is the surveillance the media likes to talk about, right? Drones and cameras all, you know, in cities and in corporate campuses. This is the police officer, very attractive, by the way, who likes to, saw me wearing Google Glass, and I don't wear it because I don't wear them because people lose their minds lately. And I said, well, look, you're wearing a camera. And he goes, yeah, I just think that's so cool. I said, well, let me take a picture of your camera. And he goes, let me take a picture of your camera. So there's all this kind of surveillance going on, which isn't a bad thing. But then there's your surveillance, right? And this is the narrative camera, and this is me out with my partner. And we were having dinner, and I couldn't remember the name of the salsa. They had six different salsas on the menu. I'm telling you, the world doesn't have a problem with resources. The world has a problem with choice. So I couldn't remember the name of the salsa, so I used the narrative app just to say, oh, I was here last time, what was the salsa I had, and did it, right? But that's self-surveillance, right? And then there's the capture audio wristband, which basically records everything until you tap it, and then it saves the last 60 seconds. So you can go through, what was that thing you said? Oh, yeah, it was really good. So self-surveillance is really good, but I think it's all based on our permission model. Ultimately, there's some really cool projects out there. There's one called Open Informant, which you can get the code off of Git and get the hardware. And basically, it's a little teeny device you can put together, and it shows you all the information you're leaking, which is really profoundly interesting. I was just in Cannes speaking at the festival there in France. And one of the things this guy was showing me was these new Samsung phones. And he said something so profound to me. And he said, it's gone from a phone that takes pictures to a camera that makes calls. And I thought to myself, how actually interesting that is. And I think for a lot of people, their phones, especially if you look at some of the newer phones with the newer information that are in the phones, they're becoming medical devices. So I think soon we'll say, you know, it's a medical device that posts pictures. You know, it's a diagnostic device. So for me, it was very simple. When I designed it, it was just technology and humanity had this kind of foundational relationship. By 2011, I added in actually this concept of knowledge lockering. So actually putting stuff in silos, what part of my life did it live in, and then how much of my whole life, not just my physical health. I think that's where people get confused. You know, just my physical health. No, you need to know what you're spending money on. And then reputation, or what we would call influencer algorithms. And then the measurement that's created there, the trust and measurement that's created here, the foundation. To 2012, when I actually debuted this at a conference and then took it to Defrag, which is what I call existence as a platform, which is your quantified existence, everything in your life, environment, body, and stuff like that. Your environment tied with algorithms, all stored in the knowledge locker to create a quantitative, qualitative, suggestive, reflective, assistive, anticipatory, antidotal, adaptive interfaces to your world. Sorry, I sped through that really quick. But remember, I'm not a UI person, and I'm not a UX person, and I'm not a computer scientist, although people keep saying, you actually are pretty smart. I'm a SQL hack, so don't forget that. But I just thought I had enough information to go, this makes sense. What happens if you took the keyboard and the screen away from life and you were the user interface? You. Well, that. And that's how it would work. So. And again, all this information's online. I don't care. You know, people are always borrowing it. So how far off was I in 2012 when I said this was going to happen between like what your body does and what the environment does and how it's stored and how it all works together? Well, luckily for us, I wasn't too far off. It was 2 years. So Apple announced HealthKit, Google announced Google Fit, and then now Samsung has announced something. So that's their health version of my model. And then Apple announced HomeKit and Google announced Nest Connect. Now, Microsoft might have some health. I know they've got Health Vault, which I love, and they had it like a decade ago. You guys might have some body thing that people on the mobile device and some environmental thing that you're actually after. But to me, I think this is a big deal that we finally have two companies, or maybe more than those companies, focusing on body and environment. You know, and once they pull those two things together, you end up with, well, that. But you'll get here. Does that make sense? So existence as a platform really then becomes the quantified self plus the internet becomes the existence as a platform. So you have your devices, applications, sensors, and services that you use every day, whether it's Facebook or a sensor in a room or just a sensor in a store. You've got engines, APIs that collect information and move them around. You've got storage and analytics and data and visualization. And then you've got user experience and activity that just happens because of the information that was collected. So what would the user interface be? It would be any of the applications you use, any of the sensors in your life, any of the devices in your life, or any of the services. You know, just using a service, you know, one of these services, to, you know, when you put a file in one of these services, what else was going on when you did that? You've got automation. So you've got services like Zapier and IFTTT and APIs that actually then can automate these things together to make things really, really simple. So you end up with these little tic-tac-toes. So you've got your application sensors, device services, your home, environment, work, and health, just a few of these. But then you could do crazy little things like if I run a mile, over a mile, lower the temperature a little bit, dim the lights when I walk in the house, and post a picture to Instagram. You know, you start playing tic-tac-toe of environmental stuff. So elaborate if-then statements. You create a very assisted environment. So that's really how I lost the weight. My environment became assisted. And then you can create what I call preconditioned environments. So now, if I have something important that I have to do, like speak at Microsoft, I actually start preconditioning up to a week in advance the environment to look at how to be most optimal for that day. Just like an athlete would train, you just use the information to say, this is what I need to do. I need to be clean. I need to not be sweating because I'm nervous. There's a bunch of things I need. And what does that look like? And how do you slowly ramp up to that moment when you actually have to do that? The power of the unaided mind is highly overrated. The real powers come from devising external, this is a wrapping, aids that enhance your cognitive abilities. That really is the power of being human, right? If we never picked up a hammer to kill a bear, we'd all, none of us be here, right? Or a rock, right? So harnessing those things to help us be ourselves. There are companies like the Human API, so just Human API, you can check them out on the web, that are taking a lot of these things, but they're just doing basically right now just behavior, just health information. They are connecting out to some genetic stuff. And they're actually becoming a platform for people to develop applications based on your systems. This is, I think they're just a ripoff of Health Vault, but you know, it is what it is. There's also services that are actually using, taking your information and making it searchable and accessible to you. And then there's this company called Exogen. It's a consumer service that actually will sequence your DNA and look for damage. So if you want to try a vitamin or something, you can see if it's working. And then there are even services that will do genetic testing on you for free, but then they push you ads. So that's how it works. So I just want to go over these, a few driving factors. I know I'm running over. I wanted to be done in 1 hour, but we started at 5 minutes after. So actually, I've got 4 minutes. So that's good, actually. consumerization of the enterprise. So everyone likes to talk about this consumerization of the enterprise. I'd like to say that it's not happening. It's actually the corporatization of the individual. We don't need to build consumer apps for enterprises. We need to build enterprise apps. We need to build corporate apps for individuals. That's what's happening. We're not taking home to work. We're becoming work. And that's not good or bad. It is. This is a great quote by Marshall. In the electronic age, by creating an instant involvement with each of us to all people, we've begun to repattern the very nature of identity. So you all are familiar with, or maybe you're not, or you've heard of mirror neurons, some neurons that actually help you be human with some people because you start to mimic their behavior and you don't seem as scary. But when you have that same type of mirror neuron relationship with other people and other systems, you start to repattern yourselves and you all become very, very identical in that way. So I think the three things that are really driving this decade and why this decade seems to be moving so fast are we have a collapse in ownership narrative and identity. The collapse in ownership comes from really this concept of, my mom wrote checks for everything. My dad would make her take money out of the bank so she wouldn't just become too dependent on checks. We'd actually take traveler's checks on vacation because we couldn't trust checks or cash because someone might steal those. Then they got credit cards and debit cards and then gift cards, then one-click buying, and then in-app purchasing, and then cryptocurrency. We've just lost a relationship with anything tangible. Not only tangible, but it's like when it's cryptocurrency, it's completely not visible. The money wasn't really real at this point, but when you get out here, you don't know what you're really dealing with anymore. I grew up with records. I can still smell, if I can smell it right now, what a record smells like. How many of you sniffed records? For those of you who are like, what the heck is going on in this talk? I can still smell them. I can remember the smell of plastic coming off the CD because I tried the first few CDs to see if it had a smell, and it does have a smell, but it's not as pretty. I'm talking about how they were shiny, when they get scratches on them, you get really paranoid like your life was going to end, like your battery's at 40% if your CD has a scratch. And then we started subscribing to digitizing our music and getting it that way. Now we subscribe to music. I've been having this thing lately where I talk to 20-year-olds and I ask them questions. And I said, what do you do? And I listen to Spotify or listen to this service or that service. I'm like, well, what do you do? If you don't want to listen to commercials, what are you doing? I just borrow my friend's login ID. So it's like the new loaning someone your album is borrowing your friend's login credentials, you know? And I'm just like, wow, I just somehow miss that people don't have a relationship with ownership when it comes to music. This, you know, the record player was a great way to play the records you bought, but once we kind of got digital, you had to have higher end equipment, got much more complicated, you know, and now you just, you can listen to your same music on here. But I'd like to clear up a misconception about, I think, tablets and phones in general. They're not consumption devices, they're purchasing platforms. Your phone is a purchasing platform, your tablet is a purchasing platform. It might as well have Visa on the side of it, because that's what you do with it. You look for stuff you will eventually buy or look to buy something. I wish we'd get rid of money and just use the devices. That would make a much more sense and take care of a lot of problems. And then, you know, Denver's full of these car-to-goes now where you don't actually have to own a car. There's a lot of examples of this collapse of ownership. I love Burner. If you're going to a conference, you use 3 Burner credits, get a temporary phone number. Everyone you meet, you give them that phone number. It lasts for 2 weeks and there goes away. They can text you, they can call you, and then it just goes away and it doesn't really matter, right? I just think it's really wildly interesting that you could, for all intents and purposes, and there was a story last year about this, live off your phone. So there was a guy last year who said he quit his job and paid his data plan and then started doing TaskRabbit for work and then started using Meetup to find free food and drink and used Couchsurfing to find places to stay and basically lived and got paid off his phone. For all intents and purposes, we call him homeless, but he was living this glorious life using microtask services to actually give and live. But these microtask services get disrupted. So Uber was disrupted by Lyft, Airbnb is disrupted by something like Couchsurfing. The important takeaway about kind of the collapse of ownership is what's happening with worth. A lot of the big tech companies that get bought, Blogger, YouTube, Instagram, SlideShare, Vimeo, Tumblr, Waze, Snapchat, you notice these prices are crazy, the companies they're getting bought for. But the thing that's even crazier about these acquisitions of some of these very popular companies is the level of ephemerability in the applications. So in Blogger, it was a very long form format. People take a lot of time to blog. YouTube, it was really hard when YouTube got bought to create videos, right? By the time in 2012, when they bought Instagram, you know, not a lot of people were doing it, but it was easier, right? SlideShare, Vimeo. Vimeo is 15-second video format. Tumblr, if you've ever been on Tumblr, it's like really fast, like watching, like, oh, I can't keep up with it, right? You know, Waze, right? Did anybody know what Waze is, W-A-Z-E? So basically, it's an application. If you're on the road, you can report, like, accidents or traffic, you know, speed traps. Huh? Police, speed traps, and things like that. But what's amazing about this, Google spent $1 billion for Waze, and how long is a speed trap information good for? In 2 hours, 3 hours? So what we're willing to pay for information that literally evaporates is ridiculous, right? Because what you throw away, everything lost, it's not saved, right? And then, you know, if you ever play with Snapchat, you know, the whole level of ephemerability in there, you know, and again, Waze, I just think, is such a perfect example. If you're willing to pay $1 billion for somebody's idea that something's happening, it's just crazy. Narrative, you know, Facebook and all of these problems are what's going on now. They show you nothing in the future and they make it impossible to search the past. The other thing about Facebook is it's one of the few places where narrative has collapsed because we live all of our ages at once. On Facebook, you can be friends with people you went to elementary school with and people that you work with now and people that you might work with or marry in the future. So you literally are all ages at once at Facebook. And we've never had a time in our history where we had a relationship with technology where we were ageless. We always were proportionally equal to our relationship with technology with our age and position in life. Now our relationships with technology are directly tied to our position in life. Television and media has also lost narrative. If any of you grew up in the 60s, 70s, 80s, or 90s, anybody grew up in the 60s, 70s, 80s, or 90s? You knew when you watched MASH or Gilligan's Island or Friends or The Brady Bunch the entire story before the show started. Here's a story of a man named Brady. Here's a bunch of people who went to war. They were shipwrecked. You knew everything. Today, it's the same Housewives of Atlanta, just the faces change, right? The same, it does not end. There is no end to this. American Idol will never end, right? It's on a continuous loop pulling forward. When you remove ownership from someone's psyche and you remove the ability to have a sense of time, people change. Websites, this is a website called Medium, they actually post stories by how long it will take you to consume them. So they understand that time is the factor here. For smokers, if anybody ever tried an e-cigarette, You don't have to admit to it. But for me, as a smoker, I thought, oh, e-cigarettes, it solves all my problems. It's healthier and I can smoke. Well, I tried one. And the first, I almost had a meltdown. They don't end. A cigarette stops. You will burn your fingers. Trust me on this one, if you continue to smoke. E-cigarettes don't stop. So we're removing our relationship to time everywhere we can. So we're in this constant state of what Douglas Rushkoff calls present shock. We cannot wake up from this relentless velocity of now. And we weaponize it, the hell out of it, to hurt each other. Books, I don't know if any of you had this happen to you, but my books are now updating the last couple of years on Kindle. The authors made new editions, had update. Books should end when you finish them. I don't know, I think there's certain like laws, like the sun comes up every day, when you finish a book, you're done, right? And then identity is the last big thing I think that's going. I think, you know, this whole idea of societal, you know, I won't go into all that, becomes very different. But this writer at Wired, who wrote the first story about me, had this really interesting thing on his blog from like a decade ago. Everybody smart did this stuff a decade ago. Yourself, your invented persona, other people's opinions become this kind of wild thing. People are obsessed with selfies now. I don't know what's going on, but selfies have been around for a long time. Even famous artists did selfies. We don't have a problem with selfies. We have a problem with judging. Online games, and then this really freaks me out because I see people doing this on Facebook for about a year, maybe 2 years now. They're using these. Have you guys seen these? They're called bit strips or something. Mm-hmm. So people like post like how they're feeling and how their day was based in cartoons. So they're like, not only have they fallen into the application, but they've become animated inside it, and that's how they communicate. Which kind of leads us to this kind of thing I'm debuting at the end of the year about identity, and it goes into, I talked about this earlier with the data needs, but your human data needs, your personal data systems, your business systems, your lifestyle, your social, your content, your vanity, your identity. So Maslow, but based on a data point, but then overlaid with Freud, ego, id, superego, and then a very opposite view from a philosopher named Alexander Bard that talks about the consumerate, which are the people who just use the internet to look at porn and buy nasty stuff versus an autocracy who use the information. So I just put all my services in there just so I could start to see what I was really doing and what type of person I was as far as identity. But identity also becomes really important when you want to escape what you've created online. So for Amazon, there was Silk Road, right? For LinkedIn, there's Glassdoor. For Facebook, there's Secret, right? So for every online network, for every online environment, there's a ephemeral, temporary identity version of it. There's something called star piloting, where you actually can give anyone who's liked any of your stuff or favorited any of your stuff access to be you for one post via the API, so they can slip into your digital skin, do one post, and then slip out. So you can loan your online identity to someone else. So it's kind of fun. Ultimately, I think it's really important because we're winding up here. What if I told you that your life is actually the user interface that you all will deal with in 10 years? So really, the foundation comes to low-friction data collection, kind reflections of yourself, ambient notifications, and what if you were the UI? I think the success model for this, and I've never shown this in public, but I'm showing it here, is a passive collection of IoT and QS tied with a nice reflection of how you're living, what your life is like, something that's nice. You know when you're doing bad, you don't need it forced down your throat, you didn't walk enough steps. Some type of analytics tied with some type of goals, I'd like to do something. And then tied to some new habits that you want or have. Then some type of store front end, so other applications and services that reinforce these things, so why not sell habit packs? And then some type of API platform that actually plugs into this that replaces login with email or login with some type of social identity. And that's what I call the existence API. I love data stories. I went to a conference last month and someone said, hey, can you just show us like what it was like to come here? So it was like everything from like when I left in the morning to the end of the day. It's a very visual version of the text version, but a lot of people like that sort of thing. But these data stories aren't extremely new. A lot of people are doing them. These are shots from the quantified self homepage of people who share their data stories. Data stories win people over and keep them engaged. Adobe has a product called Adobe Voice, where it just kind of, you talk and tell a story and then you kind of create a little story. People love these little stories. I think the most interesting thing that Facebook's doing right now, they're doing, it's not Facebook, Google. I think the most interesting thing Google's doing right now, has anyone seen Google Stories or had it pop up yet? So Google actually will take how you use your phone and turned it into a story. It plays back to you, right, from where you were, how long it took you to get someplace else, the pictures you took, and all this crazy stuff. And I thought to myself, wow, how sticky, right? You know, that's kind of really kind of interesting. Facebook did this last year with Look Back, where they gave you part of your life back. You gave Facebook a year, they gave you 30 seconds in video. But there are beautiful things you can do with this technology. This is something called Tap Tap. So it's a wristband that you wear and your spouse wears, your significant other, anyone you care about. And when you're thinking about them, you tap it and they get a vibration. You know, I think that's lovely. That's really lovely, you know? Build an ecosystem around that, you know? And then participatory, this is the guy who wrote a book. And then he recorded himself writing the book, and then the people who will read the book when it comes out will record themselves reading the book, and they'll mesh up the data. I'm going to end with who's going to prosper in kind of this kind of new economy. And I think the most important thing is the people who don't need money. And that doesn't mean you're rich. It just means you have a relationship with information that is independent of an employer. All right? You can have information to be homeless. You just need the right information. Like I said, that guy was homeless earlier. He just had enough to go by. When the only value left is time, the world becomes a clock. So everything you touch is time and information. So have a relationship with that. So thank you very much. I hammered through that in a lower, not as fast as I wanted, but I think it was really good. I got caught up with some of those kind of crazy examples. Do you have any questions about me or those concepts? I broadened the talk. I think he'll tell you I was supposed to come in and actually keep it very narrow around just my experience. But I thought my experience is interesting, but I think what's happening is more interesting because I'm a symptom of what's happening.
First, thank you for this. It's fantastic. It's really, really insightful and interesting. And
thank you.
We're all threaded into that as well. And it's a great perspective. I noticed you didn't mention anything about privacy or hacking identities or identity theft. Recently, my Visa was, you know, swiped. And in 45 minutes, someone spent gazillions of dollars and at a smoke shop and store.
Stores you would not be at.
But I just was curious what your thoughts are around sort of the vulnerabilities that we have around the cloud and all of these things that are sort of floating in the ether here.
So I have a lot to lose if I'm hacked. And I'm hacked on a daily basis. Because everyone wants to get in to see this. You know, two-factor authentication is nice. I have like 11-factor authentication. So to me, security and privacy is really important only because I get asked about it. I think, you know, unfortunately for me also because I'm very public, if I am hacked, it's gonna be news. Like the world's most connected man hacked, right? So, you know, there's a certain level of influence you have to have where you're actually, you're kind of safe from hacking because you're gonna be covered. If Barack Obama gets hacked, he's covered, but he's covered anyway because he's Barack Obama. So there's all scales all the way down to like, you know, somebody who maybe has a job at Walmart who can't pay their rent, I mean, just barely pays their rent every month, who gets hacked and has that happen to them, it wipes them out, right? And you've got professionals like you, you might get hacked and someone might say something on your Twitter or put something on your LinkedIn that gets you fired and it's just ugly. So there's a spectrum of that. Unfortunately, I think that's just the cost of digitizing information. There's a very simple concept someone told me about and I never really thought about it, but you know, if you go back, you know, 50 years, most people lived in small towns, knew everything about everybody. So, you know, privacy is a social construct that is an illusion tied around influence and money. And I think if we were honest about what privacy is and why we constructed it, we wouldn't have so much of a problem with it. Your case is very, very hurtful. Having that happen can feel scary and damaging, so I'm really sorry. But I don't have any solutions for that, and I'm afraid for me, working on solutions to build gigantic locks on things that ultimately should be yours. Because I bet even though it's stolen, you still don't know what you spend on or how you spend or where you spend. What time of day do you spend a lot? I'd have more problems with your credit card company than you, the guy who hacked you. Why won't they tell you when you're eating bad and you're using your card? Why won't they tell you when you're spending too much? So I wish I had a good answer.
You just led right into my question with that.
Of course. I'm the world's most connected person.
You know, you're right. There's data collected all the time. A lot of times we store it.
I'm speaking there, by the way.
Oh, you are?
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
In Spain.
Yeah, it is Barcelona. So I'm on the team, on the program.
Well, I've been asked to.
Been asked.
Who knows?
It makes sense.
Yeah.
It's on the future of mobility. So.
Sorry, guys. I didn't mean to. I don't know if you know why. What is it? Can you tell them what it is?
Yeah, so I work for the Innovation Outreach Program at Microsoft. So we just we work with basically 35 leading companies around the world, like top, you know, global 1,000 spread across industry, And I think of it as like a club for senior innovation executives to get together and talk about future disruptions. And
it's TED for TED.
Yeah, but it's all member funded and stuff. So anyways, yeah. we've invited Chris to come speak on the quantified.
Did you know that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're a plant. This is the audition to see if I make the cut.
but my question is, you know, I feel like such a big, you've done an amazing job to get access to your data. Mm. I've got my own theories, but what's your theory on, you know, why we can't get access to our data? I feel there's this, one of the big problems is, you know, data, companies believe data is value, revenue. And so, especially I noticed this in healthcare where I spent a few years and trying to get your information from the hospital. If it's possible, it's on paper and they charge you for it.
25 cents a sheet.
But there's this shift that's like where corporations and businesses and services start to feel an onus. It's like a barrier of entry for services to allow consumers access to their own information. Mm. What's preventing that, and how do you think it'll change, or what's the...
Well, I don't think anything's preventing. I think consumers haven't asked for it yet. I think when consumers start to ask for it, they'll get it. There are signs consumers want their data. Every time someone says privacy, what they're saying is my information. Yeah. Every time someone says surveillance, is they're saying my memories. But they just don't know how to make the transit. They just, it's me versus that thing, and like we are that thing. But companies making the ownership, I think it will happen. I think the companies that are coming along that create applications and services that reflect back to you who you are. Again, I defy you to open your phone and show me one thing that tells me who you are. Nothing. There's nothing helpful in here. It's a soul-sucking, killing machine, right? But that doesn't mean it's bad, right? I mean, there's right? Soul-sucking, killing things are good for vampires, right? And werewolves, they're good, right? But what can we do with that? So I think companies are coming along that will do something by handing your information back to you in nice ways. I think if you just took, you know, Walgreens and that took their club card, and if they actually sent you an email with statistics on your purchasing habits, they would make so many customers for life, and they'd be much more interested in signing for your club card. Every time it says to me, do you have your club card? I say, no, I have my wits. Right, you know, I have my sensibilities. I want this information. When you give, what do you mean? You know, I'm talking to a cashier at $12 an hour who hates me. So I think as companies start to turn that over, the companies that are successful, Google Stories, I think Facebook is an example of, well, let's collect information and hand it. They handed it back to people. They give them 30 seconds. But I think the companies that are kind of just nail this in the next 3 years, because it's going to flip upside down right now. You can feel the swing, are the ones that are going to hand it back in a way that makes it consumable, but is also use for you. The problem is right now, they think that it's so valuable. And if it's valuable, that creates jobs in the company and it keeps the board happy and they can, and everyone's turning, you know, look at all the information we're collecting, look at what we could do with it. Well, you don't know what to do with it. It took me, like some little guy, to say this is what you should do with it, right? And it's going to take each of you to decide what you do with it. You get a bunch of money in your paycheck every month and you decide what you do with it, right? I'm just saying, why can't you get a bunch of information and you decide what you do with it? The problem is it's not a dollar, right? It's a bunch of bits.
So I agree it's happening more, but it feels like it's part of the problem, because if you've got a bunch of companies starting to deliver the insight back and the data back to you, right? Because then if, let's say every company does that, but everybody does it in their own silo.
Exactly, we talked a little bit about silos earlier.
Yeah, so that.
That's why I call it the internet, because you know, it's very, you know, we need an open protocol for this information to make sense so that people can actually have access to it.
Across services
and across life. It doesn't have to be a computer. It doesn't have to just be health. It needs to be across things. I mean, you eat what you eat. You know, it happens. But the problem with the question you're asking is the $1 trillion question, because it actually replaces economies then. And when you talk about replacing economies, you sound like a lunatic. But how long can we go with the disparity in income and the type of work that we do? Who's going to be sitting at a desk sending emails in 10 years? No one.
I was curious about how you consume. I mean, you showed us a lot of stuff, but in terms of like just your life, like do you spend an hour a night actually reviewing your day?
Yeah.
What is your...
I used to, because it used to be kind of fun. You think selfies are fun, you should try this. I used to, but I don't anymore. I mean, now I just get feedback loops. So I was talking about, I had a small meeting with a team before this. If you take glass, wrist display, phone display, haptic display, and an environmental display, there's five different ways to get information. So now I just create alarms for information. Like, so I don't review anything, but I have elaborate routines that look for problems, just like a dashboard light. And then depending on the severity of the problem, it goes one place or all places. I prefer now environmental cues than anything looking at something. You know, we all glance at a clock how often, right? Because, you know, there's no environmental cue. Well, we had one. It was called the sun. But, you know, we love technology, so we will replace environmental cues every chance we get. God, that's good. We just kind of have to go back to that type of thinking, because I think the people who really are slightly aware and have a relationship with environmental cues will design systems around them. Disney was an amazing example of environmental cues and information and feedback. So Tower of Terror was the first ride in history that actually would randomize the rides. You never had the same ride twice. Well, now with next generation of Magic Band, you will actually be part of the ride. So your relationship to how you're feeling in the ride changes the ride. So think about that again. If this, the keyboard and this went away, and you were the interface, how would that work? So how much time? I don't spend a lot because I've got a lot of fun stuff going on, and I seem to be happening like me in this. Like, sorry, I sometimes feel like a stylist for life. God, that's another good one. So I don't. And I know. I need to. Sorry. I actually optimized for today, so it's probably why it's happening. Anyone else?
We'll probably have one more question. Yeah.
I was just curious. I mean, you've done quite a bit of kind of figuring out some of the problems, and I'm sure you've attempted to build some of your streamlined processes in a number of different ways through a variety of services. Do you have sort of your published best case mapping put out somewhere? Like, you know, I was noticing your pets, right? I have a couple of dogs, and I was like, well, I've thought about that, but they always seem a little weird and hokey, but it seems like you've wired them up. So do you have,
yeah.
I tried these three, this is the one I like.
Yeah, so I call them insights, and I have 120 of them. And I do, I'm actually in the middle of writing a book with a publisher. So they'll be there. Someone said, I'm actually working on a television show and a bunch of other crazy stuff too, so. Yeah. Don't ever do anything cute in tech. Everyone wants to. So yeah, I mean, there's just some simple things I can do, but again, I think they're individual. I think the real power of this system comes where if there's three of us that work together and we actually have good segmented data and we can say, how can the three of us work together best? Like now we should meet in an hour, right? We know that, right? We shouldn't meet today. We know that. There's certain times when you shouldn't do certain things. We know that, but you know, getting that information back to you. So for me, I mean, there's just some very simple things. I would just encourage you, if you've never played with IFTTT, have you ever played with it? And just do something very simple, like low friction location check-in. You can even use moves. Something very low friction in the background, and have it write to a spreadsheet in Office, and just have it write to a spreadsheet. And then just go look for something interesting. Most people, you know, literally take you 3 minutes to set up something to write one piece of data to a spreadsheet, and it'll change your life. So I have my own best practices, but for me to sit here and tell you yours.
Okay. Cool. So I think with that, I will thank our speaker.
Thank you.
And by the way, if you have any other questions,